Welcome to Dawg Days, a new podcast from UGASports.com. I'm your host, Dayne Young, a contributor to UGASports.com. This podcast series was designed with this in mind. We often hear from recruits. We often hear from coaches and players currently at UGA with their media availabilities. But we don't often get the stories from the Bulldogs of the past, the men and women that made the athletics program what it is, made so many memories for fans all across the nation. And so our first guest here on Dawg Days is Keith Marshall, running back for the Bulldogs from 2012 to 2015. Here he is. And our first guest here on the Dawg Days from UGA Sportscom podcast is Keith Marshall. Keith, appreciate you joining us, man. Why don't you tell our audience kind of what you're up to now?
Absolutely, man. I appreciate you having me on. So about a month ago, I decided I'm done with ball. Stop training, stop trying to, you know, get some more workouts. Going to kind of focus on trying to figure out what's next for me over the next couple of years or whatnot. Doing a little bit of real estate, trying to develop a platform to help service nonprofits on one side. And then we'll see how that goes for about a year. And if nothing shakes, I'll probably end up going back to school and get a master's degree or something. So trying to figure out life, man.
What all went into that decision to stop training? Because I know as you know, a lifelong athlete, that's a really hard decision to come to.
Oh, absolutely, man. It was definitely probably one of the harder decisions I've had to make, over the course of my life. But after a while, you know, just contemplating, I tore my patella tendon in my second year, so it would have been 2017 in camp. And I kind of had that year to rehab and hopefully, you know, was hoping to give it another shot. The next 2018 season came around, I wasn't quite ready yet. So I ended up doing a settlement, and then probably towards the end of the season, I started to get calls about teams wanting to work me out and whatnot. I just didn't feel ready yet. So, I kind of put it off a little bit, and then I was training this spring. I felt kind of good, but got to the point where I just realized my body wasn't in position to go compete at the level that you need to be able to compete at if you're going to try to make a serious run in the NFL. So I kind of decided it was time to move on.
Were you still getting calls as of this year of teams wondering your status?
No, I hadn't heard anything from since about the end of the season. I heard from a good amount of teams, probably five or six teams throughout the year last year. But, I guess teams are kind of focused on the draft and those things and the kids coming out of college. So I hadn't heard much. I heard from a couple teams, but nothing that was set in stone. So it was kind of a lot of guesswork going on. And like I said, it's kind of when you're in limbo and you're in between things and you kind of know, you know, you got to figure out something to do other than football that's not going to be what works. After a while, I kind of got tired of waiting and probably dealt with a little anxious about getting going in something else.
Well, let's kind of take it back to your beginning. I'm curious, when did you realize, hey, I'm pretty good at this sports thing? I mean, I know you're from a sports family. I know your dad was into it. Your brother just had a contract signing with the NFL. So kind of take me back to when you realized, I got a shot at this.
Honestly, man, I mean, growing up, you know, like you said, I come from an athletic background, so we always played around, and I was always very involved in sports and school and stuff. I kind of always was the fastest as far back as I can remember. Up in, you know, kindergarten, second grade, we race out win. Then I started playing football in second grade, and immediately kind of found success. My first year was kind of the little football star around my town growing up. And obviously my pops played ball, so growing up watching his highlights from the time I was, you know, as far back as I can remember, I always definitely had a passion for it, had an itch for it, and, you know, it was a great ride. I mean, I kind of got a chance to live out one of my dreams from the time I was 5 to the time I was 25. It's not too many people that can say they did that, so, it was a great experience.
So if I could locate video of Keith Marshall on a football field when he's 5 years old or second grade or whenever it was, what kind of like little boy athlete would I have seen then? I mean, was it some of these crazy videos you see of just one kid running around everybody?
I have the videos and everything. I haven't looked at them forever, but I still have them. And I was pretty good.
Let's skip ahead to high school, Millbrook High School in Raleigh. And I'm assuming that the coaches there were just eager to get a football in your hands.
Yeah, man, like I said, I was definitely known as a football guy around Raleigh, North Carolina, where I grew up. But thing I never really told anybody, and especially getting recruited, because you kind of try to suppress certain things. You don't want coaches to find out. You got to kind of play that game. I tore my ACL when I was in seventh grade. So I had to wear this big old Don Joy knee brace every time, anything I did, anything. So I was very self-conscious. And I didn't have much confidence just because I had to wear that. And so I had to wear that until 10th grade. So ninth grade year, I was on JV a little bit. I ended up not playing much because of that. And then I came back in 10th grade, trained really, really hard. My dad got me with a great trainer in Raleigh, North Carolina after my ninth grade year. And I trained really, really hard because I knew there was an opening for the varsity running back spot. And first game we played a pretty good team. Supposed to be a big game. And I had like 5 touchdowns. And the next day, I started getting offered. I think UNC offered me the next day. Georgia was a few days after that. So literally within, 2-3 weeks, my whole trajectory of everything kind of changed. And it was surreal because I remember watching a lot of the like rivals and scout and ESPN 150 and all that stuff growing up. Like I was very into it because that was my dream. So I remember, watching all the top running backs the years before me. And probably, I was supposed to be doing other things, doing homework. I was on the TV, on the computer, looking up who was who. And then, a year later, I was a part of that. So it was a very surreal experience to kind of go through that whole recruiting process. And it was really awesome, man. So, yeah, I finished up high school. Had a great career. We didn't necessarily win a whole bunch, but made a lot of great, friendships, had some great coaches that I learned a lot from. And I kind of took it to Georgia after that.
When you tore your ACL, that first time, do you remember how it happened? Do you remember the play? Were you scared? Tell me about that process.
Yeah, I was super scared. I was, like I said, I was, 7th grade. You were 10 or 13. You were 13 years old, 12 or 13. So, yeah, I had never had anything like that before. I was playing middle school boxing before my middle school and kind of got twisted up behind, like, a D lineman. And he fell on me, big old dude. And so I jacked up my ankle and my knee. And it was super swollen. I remember having to carry me off the field. It was just crazy. I actually remember like being very emotional. That's probably the last time I did get emotional. And I remember asking my mom, does she still think I could possibly play in the NFL or go to college? And she was like, yeah. It was kind of scary at that age. I felt like all my dreams were kind of, it was fracturing some of the dreams I had for myself. So it was a crazy experience.
So did that stop you from playing other sports? Because I know you ran track too.
I didn't. Everything. I had a little scope, and they did what they had to do, and I was good to go. But it just took a couple years to get back from. I actually think, though, having to rehab and work so hard to rehab at that young is kind of might be what propelled me forward, because I was working so much harder than a lot of the other kids because I was having to overcome that. So I think, if anything, it might have propelled me. I kind of decided I was going to focus on football in high school, so I stopped playing basketball and stuff in middle school.
But you still kept running track, right?
Well, yeah, track is kind of seen as like a, it's a part of football. It's a way to train in the off season. I was always like a very fast dude, so we always ran track. And that was kind of a, that definitely was second fiddle to football.
I gotcha. All right, so the recruiters are calling. You said you got the offers from UNC and then UGA came after that. Tell me about the recruiting process, because I don't think a lot of people understand what it's like to be on the player end of that, because it's a whole lot of attention, not only from the coaches and the fans, but from media. So what's that like as a teenager in North Carolina to all of a sudden have all this attention on you?
Yeah, it's crazy. Like I was saying, all of a sudden you have dreams of going and doing big things. And, obviously you want to go to these big colleges that you've, watched growing up. And then all of a sudden you got coaches on the phone from these colleges telling you, they offer you a scholarship. You're going to be the next big thing. They can tell you the whole history of the school. And it's really surreal. And I kind of have I don't pay attention to it too much, but I see stuff on Twitter every now and then. And it reminds me of where I was, kind of seeing some of the stuff that these recruits are doing and going through and the attention that they're getting. And I think it's kind of bad for, it's definitely bad for the ego. It's inflating a lot of kids' ego and puts them in a position where it could set you up for failure down the road. But I guess it is what it is. So, I was very fortunate to have my father, who played at a high level, and he kind of knew the game. So he kind of walked me through it and made sure I didn't get overly consumed in it. But I was just like every kid, I was still consumed in it. Every day, different reporters. I'm 16 years old. Reporters calling you, want to do interviews, and you go on. You're reading these clips and stuff in the newspaper and online about how great you are. It's a great experience. But if you're not careful, you can get lost in it for sure. I think a lot of kids definitely do.
Who was your favorite recruiter? Which coach was your favorite that recruited you?
BMAC, Brian McClendon, which is why I ended up coming to Georgia. It was him. There was another guy out of South Carolina. Those are pretty much the only two guys that I I mean, I'm not gonna say that. I liked a lot of coaches, but they were at programs that I liked, and then I feel like I had a real relationship with him. And Coach McClendon, who I know he's at South Carolina now, I couldn't say enough good things about him. The same guy that recruited me was the same guy I dealt with at the University of Georgia. And, you know, like I say, recruiting the game, so a lot of people aren't fortunate enough to be able to say that with the people that recruited them. So I'm very thankful that I played under him.
And, you know, one of the positive things that you hear about people like BMAC is he played for the school that he is recruiting for. So, you know, that's what they say about Kirby Smart, too, and that's one thing that helps him now. Could you sense that, like, passion when he was recruiting you?
Well, absolutely. But like I said, I think it was more personal. I mean, Georgia, you know, it's kind of crazy. Georgia recruits for itself. The history, you know, it's big time, you know what I'm saying? So it's really about that relationship I built with him. And just kind of, like, I felt like he was honest with me. I had a lot of schools tell me, you know, you come here, you'll start day one. But, you know, and all of this, you know, like I said, they inflating the ego. And, you know, I'm a high school player, haven't played, stepped foot on college campus. How could you possibly know I'm going to step into the SEC and do this or that? And a lot of coaches were saying that. And so when Coach McClendon was like, well, you have a chance to compete. Like, I can promise you, you have a chance to compete. You'll get what you earn. I respected that. Something about that approach, it made sense to me. That's kind of how I was raised, so it resonated with me. And that's what happened. So, you know, that's kind of what got me at Georgia.
What's the craziest thing that a coach told you in recruiting? The craziest, like, zaniest thing that stuck in your head or something that you and your family laughed at?
I mean, I couldn't even. One thing that was absolutely amazing, though, and no disrespect to him because I know it's part of the game, but Charlie Weiss, when he was at Florida, they came to my house for an in-home visit, and let's say it's Thursday. So he's sitting on my couch. My mama cooked dinner, you know, looking us in our face, and he's telling us how I think he had a son that wanted to coach, and he was going to be a student coach at Florida. So he was selling Florida. He was saying how he was going to retire down there. That was the best spot ever for him. He loved it. His son was going to get a student coach under him. I think he had a daughter that was special needs. They had a great program for her. I think his wife loved horses. He bought her a ranch down there. He's just like, I'm going to be here. This is how I'm going to use my offense, blah, blah, blah. And come Sunday night, he's the head coach at Kansas. And so we're just like, there's no way he didn't know that was going to happen when he was sitting 2 days ago, you know, in our living room telling us this. So it was just funny. But like I said, man, I understood the game. You know, it is what it is. But I couldn't, there's so much crazy stuff and stuff you hear, stuff they'll tell you about you the next this and that I couldn't even really begin to even remember a lot of the stuff, man.
Well, I think that's what a lot of fans don't realize is that these coaches, they're expert salesmen. I mean, that's half of the job. So when you hear that from Charlie Weiss, I mean, there's no telling who else he was telling that same story to.
No, exactly, man. I mean, it is what it is. Like I keep saying, it's part of the game, but it isn't something. That's why I don't like when fans give, you know, players a lot of slack for going somewhere and they want to leave or they're unhappy and now they're not team players and all this stuff. And it's like, you gotta understand, these kids come from all over the country. They come with dreams. Obviously they want to be a part of the program and they want to have a great team and win, but obviously they have their individual goals and things they would like to pursue as well. And so if coaches are lying to them to get them to come somewhere, which they're all selling dreams, because nobody knows until you step on campus what you can actually do. So, you know, if a kid goes and he's told something, he doesn't feel like he got the opportunity, I feel like it's very obvious. It makes sense that they would be unhappy. And it is about the team, but it's also about the kids' dreams. And, you know, you're sitting in there telling their families that you're going to treat them a certain way and this, that, and the third. When that doesn't happen, unfortunately for me, it happened. So I didn't have to deal with it. But I've heard horror stories. I know people from all over the country that play different places. And some of the things you hear is just like, it's so disingenuous that I can't, in good conscience, I couldn't say anything negative about the players that want to get out of that situation. And so I think, you know, that gets lost in the sauce because everybody's, you know, focused on the team. The fans are focused on the teams, which they should be. But it's a lot more than that goes into it.
Well, you're seeing how the transfer portal is changing the game. Is that something that you think is positive for the game or something that you wish would have been maybe more available when you were there?
I mean, positive, negative, I don't know. You know, I could debate either way, honestly. But I will say that the coaches are allowed to do it, so it's fair. You know, if you commit, you know, for the next 4 years to go play for a certain coach, which I would advise against recruits doing that, but some do, and the coach ups and leaves, now, you know, this is your whole future. You know, what you do in college, you know, especially as an athlete at a football, he has the potential to set you up for life. So it's not a decision to take lightly. Like, it's a lot of that you have riding on these decisions. So I think if the coaches can tell you that they're going to stay somewhere and up and leave because somebody offers them more money or because they had a bad season and there's no penalty to them, then it's hypocritical for you not to let the players leave when stuff doesn't go their way. But we obviously we know who's getting paid the big dollars and who kind of doesn't really have a dog in the fight per se, because they have no, you know, they don't have anything to stand on. So it seems like it's trending towards, you know, having given the players a little more ability to control, you know, their destiny a little bit, and I think I like that.
Yeah, it definitely makes sense with the, you know, the way, like the Charlie Weiss story that you just said. Like, if he can recruit you like he did and then up and leave, then...
Yeah, I mean, if I would have signed my letter of intent, I'm locked in. And he, you know, I mean, that's just, that's not, there's nothing fair about that. So, you know, I'm not going to act like it is.
All right, let's skip ahead to your UGA days. So, I guess right before that, it's kind of a legend. If you go to your Wikipedia page, it talks about how, you know, you were one of the guys recruiting Todd Gurley. So kind of tell me about your relationship with Todd in recruiting and then kind of heading into your freshman year.
Yeah, so me and Todd, we were boys. We met, I think maybe in 10th grade. We were both running track. You know, we bumped into each other. We became friends pretty right off the bat, just because, you know, I was dealing with going through the recruit process and he was as well. So we had a lot to talk about and very similar situation we were in. There was another kid named Ronald Darby. So the three of us, he ended up playing at Florida State. He's playing with the Eagles now. The three of us, we used to call each other multiple times, some weeks, every week, every day. I mean, and just talk about different stuff, what college we wanted to go to. We all wanted to go to the same school. So me and Todd, we ended up going on a lot of our, I think, two or three of our officials together. And actually, the day before I committed, I was on the phone with him and Ronald Darby up until probably 3 a.m. talking about what school we were going to go to. And we didn't decide on Georgia, but I just woke up in the morning and I had that, you know, I just had that feeling. So I ended up coming to Georgia, and then obviously I recruited Todd to try to come to join us, you know, so the rest is history.
How close were you getting Darby to join you?
Darby, I think he would have come. Georgia wasn't serious about recruiting him for whatever reason. He was he was kind of an athlete coming out, and he played running back, but he wanted to play DB. And obviously he was a great DB. Probably one of the better ones in the NFL right now, so it worked out well for him. But I think if Georgia would have showed serious interest, I think he probably would have come.
All right, so you get on campus, you and Todd, the rest of the freshmen. That first summer when you're going through workouts, how much of a culture shock is that when you're doing SEC training?
So I came in the spring, so I came in early. Like, I think a lot of people still do that. And so, I mean, it was a shock, but the shock really didn't hit me until after the first season. But I mean, going through some workouts, it was real. But you know, we worked out hard in high school too, so it was a little different just because it's all year round. But as far as the culture shock, you know, you come in, you have your head down, you work, you do what you're told. It wasn't really, you know, I was just following the rules. I was doing what people was telling me to do, taking the examples from older guys that have been successful, and that's kind of what I did. I think that's what most young guys should do if they don't do when they come in. So It wasn't too hard to adjust to be completely honest.
So early in that season, you've got the famous Missouri, the grown man football, the old man football. Take me into the locker room or that practice week of what the feeling on the team was like, understanding that Sheldon Richardson had, you know, said Georgia was playing old man football.
Yeah, I mean, so that was my second collegiate game ever, my first away game. So the whole experience was a first. Obviously, it was their first SEC game, so that was the big deal everybody was talking about. I know during the season, we really don't get, you know, I don't know what they do now. We didn't get too involved with what was going on in the media. Obviously, we heard it, and it was a big deal because it was their first home SEC game. So I remember we went up there. You know, that place was rocking. And, you know, like I said, it was my first experience, period, being away. So I definitely remember it. But I just remember it wasn't a great locker room. You know, you know how they do you when you go away. You kind of get it's not like it doesn't really have everything you need. But we came out there. I remember there were so many people, it was so loud. Everybody was excited. It was a great experience. And we ended up winning the game. It was a close game. Jarvis Jones, you know, he's a legend.
That dude was nuts that night.
Exactly. So it was definitely a great game.
All right, so you win that, and then probably one of your best games as a collegiate player is the home win in 2012 against Tennessee. You get a couple touchdowns. Todd goes off. You know, it's one of the more explosive offensive games that Georgia's ever had. Did it seem like everything was just going right that day?
Oh, it did, man, but it just felt like we had been, you know, myself, I feel like I had been getting better and better, and it kind of, that game was, indication of that. And I feel like the team was – it was a close game, though. I do remember it was a pretty close game. We all played well. It was just – I know that was when it kind of blew up, though. That's when I felt like, all right, we're here. Like, it's been, you know, we're here now. Because there was a lot of media attention after that game. Obviously, they were talking about – I think it was very to the beginning of the season, if I can't remember correctly.
Yeah, it was one of the
– I think after that game is when I started to get somewhat of a name, and it's a lot more notoriety stuff started coming early on.
Well, it was the combined name, because that's probably when Gershel was born, right? And that became a really big thing in your freshman year.
Yeah, that sounds right, man. I remember that story kind of went nationwide, and it was kind of surreal.
So then it all kind of is going in the right direction. And then the Dawgs head over to Columbia.
South Carolina, yes, sir. I'll never forget that.
Tell me what happened that day.
I don't know what happened, man. I just remember that I remember our defense was so good the year before. So, like, I thought, you know, we had the best defense. I was thinking, like, coming in, like, yo, we got the best defense in the country. Offense, we're great. I remember we going to South Carolina. We couldn't get anything going offensively. And I think we were ranked higher. We were for sure ranked higher. We couldn't get anything going offensively. And then they were scoring left and right. And it was just like, I couldn't believe it. I remember being like in the fourth quarter and it's 28-0. And I'm finally thinking like, oh, we might actually lose. Like the whole game, I'm thinking there's no way we're going to lose this game. I just had so much confidence in us. But it was definitely a shock. I think it was necessary, though, because after that game, we kind of had a couple more bad games. But then we went into maybe we went into Florida, we can slide. Sean Williams, he kind of got on the team, he had called a team meeting. He kind of told us what was real, what we needed to hear. And after that, he kind of turned it around. And that's, you know, that season ended up being a pretty good season.
What did he say, though? You say he said what you needed to hear. Tell me some of the words that Sean said.
I can't remember. To be honest, I can't remember verbatim. It was just kind of like, you know, we're not as good as we think we are. We almost, we just got our tails whooped. And we almost lose to Vanderbilt.
Yeah, that was a close game. Yeah.
Yeah, so it was like that happened, and he was like, we're just not what we think we are, you know what I mean? And kind of just that wake-up call, because they had a SEC championship this previous year, number one defense in the country the previous year. So, you know, he was just kind of establishing the fact that we haven't proved ourselves yet this year. We can't live off that. So something to that effect, I'm assuming.
You beat Florida, you beat Kentucky, you beat Ole Miss. But kind of the statement game late in that season was the shutout over Auburn. Do you remember that night? 38-0 over Auburn.
Yeah, I don't think Auburn was a good that year, though, I don't think.
Yeah, they weren't. they were pretty pathetic that year.
They were good?
No, they were pathetic. That's when they fired Gene Chizik.
Yeah, I was about to say. So, yeah, I don't remember that being. Yeah, I remember we beat them pretty good, but I thought they were actually really bad that year.
Yeah,
so
it was
supposed to win that game.
That was an away game. Georgia goes into Jordan-Hare Stadium, blows them out, wins the SEC East title at their stadium. I'll give you a story about this, because after the game, I covered that in local TV. You know, all you guys are celebrating on the field, and I go into the locker room, and Todd Gurley's in there, and I was asking him, I was like, so what was the celebration like on the field? And you know what Todd tells me? Todd says, I didn't get to celebrate. I had to come in and use the bathroom.
Yeah, that sounds like Todd. I ain't gonna lie, that sounds like that boy's stomach used to be crazy.
Oh, I don't have a follow up question for that. I don't know if that deserves any more airtime.
Yeah, I will leave that alone.
All right, so you know the next question. We skip ahead to the SEC championship. You had to feel like if you get through that, you're in a national championship, right? I mean, was that the team sentiment?
Yeah, I mean, we would have been. I mean, we would have been playing Notre Dame for national championship. We probably would have given them the same thumping that that Alabama gave them. But I remember that game was crazy, because I think it was the third quarter. Tree blocked the field goal kick, and he ran it back. And I remember, I think the championship was like it was either in like Miami or Orlando, somewhere down there. National championship was. And I remember being on the sideline thinking like, yo, we're about to go to the national championship game, because we were up by like 2 touchdowns, and it was kind of getting towards the point in the game. I feel like, you know, the game couldn't got away from them, but you know, Alabama, you know how they always find a way against us for whatever reason. I don't know what it is, but they inched their way back and ended up winning. I guess when they ended up holding on, it was just, you know, when the clock hit zero, it was almost like I was in shock. Like, I couldn't believe it actually was over. Like, it didn't resonate initially that the game was over. Okay. And that we weren't going to. I had already accepted the fact that we were about to go to the national championship game in my mind.
And that's a dangerous place to be as a football player, whenever it is, right?
Oh, absolutely. I wasn't playing much that game, but I felt like I was very confident in our team that year. Like, I genuinely thought, you know, there was every time we strapped up the helmet, I thought we were going to win. It was almost like there's no doubt in my mind we're about to beat this team. So, you know, that's like you said, it might not be the best place to go in, but I was definitely confident.
And so that last drive begins, and I mean, Murray was finding people left and right, whether it was Artie Lynch, or, you know, you get down to the 4-yard line, and I mean, we all know what happened there, but you know, did you just think that it was like the story, there was going to be the storybook ending of, we're going to come back, we're going to get this, and it, like, did you ever lose that belief that it was going to happen?
That's what I'm saying, I did. Like, in my mind, I knew we were going to win, so that's why I was such a shock. Like, I remember we met in the huddle before the last drive, the 2-minute drill. And everything we talked about, come out, we're executing, moving the ball, everything's going up according to plan. I'm like, we got it. And then, you know, last second, it didn't go exactly like, everything went right except for the last, you know, the very end. So it was a shock.
And then just from a player perspective, what's an off season like after that? I mean, I know you had the bowl game, but, you know, that was kind of a consolation at that point.
Yeah, so I mean that's what I'm saying. College football didn't really hit me until after the season, because like I said, I came in early, so I came in January, so I linked up with the team right after they had just finished the previous year. Went through the whole spring, went through summer workouts, camp, season. All right, I got a year under my belt. We go to the bowl game, might get to go home for 2 or 3 days, and we come back and it's like workouts start back over. And I was like, oh my god, like there's no off season. Like that's when it hit me. Like, okay, this is different. And so I ended up running the winter workouts. I ended up running track my freshman year. Me and Ty both ran track a little bit. So we didn't do as much of the workouts because we were competing in track. But still, dude, I just remember that feeling of like I could definitely use a little break, you know. But that's the grind. That's what you go through for 4 years. It's nonstop.
Do you think that they should allow more time for breaks, whether it be in between seasons or in summer or – do you think it's healthy for as much as players have to go through?
I think it's kind of a loaded question, because obviously if it was something that was mandated, I think it could be good for everybody. I mean, the coaches are grinding all year too. They could use a little more time with their families and stuff, but the competitive nature of what college football is, you're not going to let anybody get an advantage on you. So the fact that every other team is working, you got to go to work. You know, that's just, you know what you're competing against, and there's no shortcut. Everybody knows that you get in what you put out. So you get out what you put in. So I think it's necessary, but I think it would be good if, you know, in the NFL you get a 90-day period where you're off. You can't go to the facility. Like, it's no football. You get 90 days. And a lot of people take, you know, the first month to just completely off, just do easy stuff, take care of your body, kind of fix up yourself from the season, and then they start back training slowly. It's not like you jump right back into it. I think it would definitely be better for the longevity of the athletes if they had, you know, a little more mild schedule, but that's just like I said, it's the nature of the beast. Yeah. It's what you sign up to do. It's what you got to do. So
you're working in that off season. You get into 2013. It's a tough loss to Clemson to start the year, especially after what happened in 2012. So that's just a sour taste for players, fans, coaches, everybody. But then the LSU game comes, and Keith, I'll tell you, a lot of people that I know that were around the program at the time say that is one of, if not the best game that they've ever seen in Sanford Stadium.
Mm-hmm. I remember a special game. I remember Justice Scott Wesley. That's what I remember about that game. He ended up scoring at the very end of the game, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. But it was just a shootout. I mean, you know, a piece of it, at least from the media side, it was the Murray versus Mettenberger, but it was just a shootout the whole way.
Todd went down that game. I remember now because Todd got hurt that game, so I think I was the only guy playing really in the second half. I remember that. Yeah. The game right before that was kind of like it too. When we played South Carolina, very similar.
Yeah, South Carolina was close too. Yeah. Let's go to Tennessee though, because that's the screenplay, ACL. The quote that you had after it, you said, "It changed my life. It changed everything." What did you mean by that?
Oh, I mean, it just sat you down for a little bit and let you, you know, just like any injury, if you get away from something that you love, that you're doing, you're having some success at, kind of lets you get some perspective of how fragile that is. So, you know, after I got hurt, I kind of realized that, you know, you won, played away. You know, some people get hurt, don't get to play anymore. I know, you know, ACL is not the worst thing in the world anymore, but I have just kind of had to deal with that. So I ended up changing my major to something a little harder. Started, I mean, I was very focused in school already, but I tried to a little bit more. I still didn't do it as much as I should have, but like, I took it seriously. Like, okay, I need to start networking. I need to make sure I'm set up in case football doesn't work out, or, you know, just kind of let that perspective set in. And then, you know, obviously coming back from that injury didn't, you know, it wasn't the best process in the world, but definitely a lot of perspective, a lot of personal growth away from the game when you get hurt like that.
Was it the same knee that you tore your ACL in middle school?
Nah, it was actually the other knee.
So then you, all of a sudden you're in the middle of college and you've torn ACLs in both knees. Although, like you said, I guess most people did not know that.
Yeah, I mean, that's the nature of football, man. Everybody kind of, you know, get hurt. That's just part of the game. I remember that year, I remember we was kind of banged up already. Like, I was having some, like, tendonitis and stuff. So I actually remember getting hurt and thinking this might have been, you know, which I was very religious. So I was like, this might be what God intended for me to sit down for a little bit and regather, allow some of the other stuff I had going on the hill. And so, you know, just try to look at it in a positive light. My parents, you know, they played a big role in trying to keep my mind right. And obviously I'm still young, and in my mind, I still got the whole, you know, my whole career ahead of me. So I don't think I was in as bad a place as I could have been, but it definitely was different.
That season finishes at 8-5 for Georgia. There's the prayer at Jordan-Hare for Auburn that eventually...
Man, I remember, I'll never forget that. So I had to wait. When I got hurt, I had some, I did some other stuff. So I had to wait on that to kind of clear it before I could have surgery. And so when I did have surgery, I did it on both my knees because I had stuff going on my other knee, so they cleaned that out. So I was in like a little wheelchair, little thing old people drive around the grocery store. I had one of those. And I remember sitting in front of my screen, like in my dorm room, sitting in front in that little thing, watching the, literally, this is like my first few days out of surgery, watching that play. And I remember, like, Nick Marshall obviously was a quarterback. I remember he threw the ball. I'm looking, I'm like, oh, it's not long enough. We're good. Like, I remember, like, excited. And then I watched it get tipped and they catch it. And it was like, I cannot believe this just happened. I just went into my room and talked to nobody for the rest of the day.
So that's interesting, because so you're still a player on the team, obviously, but because of your injury, you experience this as a fan.
Absolutely. Like, I mean, I was watching on TV.
What did your phone look like after that game? I mean, what were the text messages with the guys?
I can tell you, man. Look, I used to kind of just ignore everybody. Like, I would go dark. So I probably just didn't talk to anybody for a while. I remember I actually did get, I got into somebody on Twitter because they were talking junk about some of the teammates. And like you said, like, so being a fan kind of my own team during the game, I'm able to see all the talk on Twitter and people talking about people, and I was mad already. So I was interacting with people. I probably should have just left it alone, but Yeah, I remember, yeah, for sure.
All right, so let's go 2014. We'll kind of cruise through a couple of these. Dawgs get a couple wins. You get injured again, this time versus Troy. I mean, like you were saying, were you already beat up heading into that game? Because there was kind of like, it was murky afterwards of what the injury specifically was.
Yeah, I mean, I think I was good. Like, I was clear, but it's just one of those, I still having pain a little bit, still working through some things, probably starts, which I don't know exactly what it was. My knee was still swelling up a good amount, but I obviously wanted to play. Like, I knew, you know, we got Nick and Sony coming. I know those boys, how good they were, so I was like, I can't just sit out. And so I tried to get back, and it ended up getting twisted up again a little bit. I kind of just decided to redshirt the rest of that year. You know, talk with my family and then talk with some of the coaches. We like just get healthy. So that's kind of what I decided to go.
In the preseason of that year, did you guys just look around? You got you, Todd, Sony, and Nick. And did you just marvel about how much talent was in one room?
We didn't think about it. I mean, now you look back, it's kind of, you know, surreal. But at the time, it was like they were big recruits, but they weren't, you know, so they hadn't played yet. So we knew they had potential, but it was just, so that's Georgia. Like, Georgia always gets, they're always going to have that type of talent. It might not always manifest itself that way like it did with them, but, like, Georgia's always going to have people that have potential to do some of the things they did. So that's just part of playing right back at Georgia. Like, that room is going to be talented, which is great because, you know, you can feed off that and it makes you better.
Do you ever think that you were the same after your 2013 injury and maybe even your 2014 injury? Like, were you ever back to being Keith?
I don't know, man. I used to say I was all the time. I don't know. There was times I felt good, yeah. I think, like, looking back, I got too big and some other stuff. Like, I had tendonitis really bad. That was one of those things where it's like you could play through it, but it's very painful. You know what I'm saying? It's just ain't nothing you could really do for it. So once you start dealing with that, it was more pain tolerance. Like it was definitely certain cuts and certain things I just knew in my head, like I had to think about rather than just reacting. I think that definitely took a little toll, but I felt like I was still able to compete.
And you still contribute. I mean, 2015, you played in 11 games. But obviously, what marked that season was just all of the rumors about the coaching search, and we know eventually what happened. And, you know, Mark Richt was your coach the entire time that you were at Georgia. How difficult is it for a team to kind of experience a season when an impending coaching change is in the process of happening?
It was definitely difficult, man. It was just that year was definitely a lot of turmoil, a lot of stuff that, you know, people knew what was going on. It's kind of like a family, like, you know, your parents can tell you that nothing's going on, but if you could just sense it, like, you know what I mean? You just know. So, like, the coaches, they try to do their best to keep a lot of that stuff away from us, but we heard enough rumors and, you know, we saw enough things and it was just enough change already going on. We could kind of feel what was happening. And so, I mean, there was a lot of internal stuff going on that year, I feel like. That, you know, probably has been documented already. But it was definitely an interesting year. You know, brought a new strength staff, new offensive coordinator, and it just was it was definitely interesting.
I mean, at any point, did you go up to B-Mac since he was your guy and just be like, hey, what's going on?
Yeah, I did. But, you know, coaches, it's a lot of politics that go in. You know, obviously everybody knows a lot of politics that go into play. So, you know, you could talk to, like, TB who came in. Me and TB had a good relationship. Still, to this day, I still talk to TB. And, you know, sometimes they can't really, because of what their position, they're not able to, they can't really indulge in a certain question. So they kind of talk around it. And that's just kind of what it is. You know, they it's not, they're like, they're not in control of everything either. So I can go talk to B-Mac, but there's certain things that he shouldn't talk to me about because of the position he's in. And kind of, you understand all those power plays. But, I mean, we knew stuff was going on. It was obvious.
Do you have a favorite Mark Richt story? Anything funny about him or... you know, he was at Georgia for a long time, so there are a lot of stories about him and his personality.
Yeah, I mean, Coach Rick was so mild-mannered, man. It was anytime he got excited, it was like it was something that was going on. I don't really have one specific story. I just think, you know, Coach Rick is genuinely, you know, everybody has their opinions of people, but I think Coach Rick is one of those people. He's genuinely a good guy, and there's no doubt about that. I think sometimes that may have even come into conflict with certain decisions that you have to make as a coach. You know, he's such a good guy. The way that he lived his life as far as his morals, I feel like a lot of time, you know, he stuck to them and that put maybe some strain on other areas. I don't know. I'm just kind of speaking off of what I think. I could be way off. But I think he's genuinely a good guy. I think a lot of there's not as much of that anymore probably in college sports. And I think, you know, it's more of a business now. He kind of ran it like a family. Like, you know, the wives and the kids, they were always around. You know, he had his kids on the sideline helping make us juice and putting candy in our lockers before the game, stuff like that. And it's just, that's the kind of guy he was. So it was definitely great. I mean, I went to play under that. So, you know.
I'm going to go rapid fire through some things because we got to wrap this up here in a second. So best practice play, best play that you saw in practice, whether it be you, a teammate, someone else, what's the craziest thing you saw in a practice?
First practice, spring practice, I saw Alec Ogletree jump up, seemed like 100 feet in the air, and snatch an interception like one-handed.
That dude's nuts, isn't he?
Yeah, it was ridiculous.
Favorite UGA game, your favorite one?
Favorite UGA game, I'd probably say Tennessee freshman year.
What's your stance on Georgia, Florida, Jacksonville, that whole conversation?
I'm not familiar with that conversation.
Well, it's just, there's a debate if the game should be played in Jacksonville or whether it should be played on campus. I didn't know if players had an opinion one way or the other.
I don't care. I thought the atmosphere was cool, but I think it would be cool to go to, you know, to alternate as well. So, I think it matters that much.
What's the fastest 40 time you've ever run?
I run 4.1 hand time for sure.
That's crazy.
Yeah, the hand time, the laser is different. So, if someone runs a 4.2 laser on the hand time, they're running.
When was this? When did you run the 4.1?
I ran it in training up to the combine. I think I ran one in college before. We didn't really test that much in college. But I remember a couple times. I remember Coach Gus pulled me aside one time and was like, yo, you just ran something crazy. I can't even write it down. I don't know if y'all remember Gus Felder.
Yeah. What's the hit that you remember that a defensive player delivered against you?
I don't know who hit me, but we were playing North Texas, and one of those linebackers hit me. And I stayed up, but I was a little dizzy afterwards.
I did not expect you to say North Texas. I ain't going to lie.
Man, they had some dogs, man. They were hitting.
What's the hardest hit that you delivered on someone?
Hardest hit I delivered. I knocked the dude's helmet off one time. We played Ole Miss. I'll go with that.
What's your favorite Athens meal?
Favorite Athens meal would probably be food for the soul and Butt Hut.
You alluded to this earlier. You said you changed your major because it wasn't hard enough?
Yeah, kind of, yeah.
What was it? What'd you change it to?
I was business management. I switched it to business finance.
Man, I know you're a smart guy, but Terry's hard, man. That's a hard college.
Yeah, it was difficult, but I mean, you know, I felt like I was selling myself short a little bit. Not to say anything bad about management, but I wasn't having to apply myself that much.
What's the practice story that still makes you laugh? That, like, you and your boys, if you're hanging out, you think about this story and y'all just, like, cackle with each other?
I'll be honest with you, I got a lot of stories, but a lot of them, you know, I can't really share. So,
oh man, that's the ones I want.
So coach, you know, it'll be days, and this happened multiple times, it'll be days where it'll say 100% chance of thunderstorming. It'll be thunderstorming all day. As soon as we walk out onto the field, it's sunny. As soon as we walk off the field after practice, it starts thunderstorming again. So we used to always say Coach Rick had a weather machine.
Man, there were so many stories written about weather stuff because they didn't have the indoor practice facility then either. So then there was all the stuff about, like...
Yeah, we used to be happy. When it was thunderstorm, we'd be happy because we know we're not practicing.
Why is Tupac your Twitter picture?
I love Tupac, man. I like what he stood for.
Fair enough. Let's go through your opinion on the current Dawgs. Well, let me ask this. If your running back crew ran behind the current offensive line, what would that look like?
Hey, man, I enjoyed the offensive line we ran behind. The boys that got up there, they definitely got some dogs. They seem to be beefed up a little bit, but we had some great players we ran behind, too, so, you know.
Do you have a relationship with any of the current running backs? I mean, you and Zamir are both from, you know, nearby areas.
Yeah, I know Zamir. I rehabbed for a little bit in Georgia this last time, so I got to rehab a little bit with him. I can't speak highly enough of him, man. He's great, great kid, humble, respectful. I mean, he's top notch. I just really enjoy being around him. I enjoy how the way he carries himself with everything he's been through, the way he treats other people. To me, will set him apart in life. I've met Swift a lot. He seems like a great kid as well. Obviously, he's extremely talented. Brian Harry, and I think he's the most underrated back. I don't know why anybody doesn't talk about him. Me and my boy just talking about the other day. I feel like he'll be a good NFL running back. Like, he'll definitely get opportunity. So I think that room has a lot of talent.
Zamir is huge, man. Like, if you stand beside him, he's a freak.
He is, man. He stopped lifting all the weights. Boy, he's big. He's big. He's probably two. I don't know how big he is, but he looks the part, that's for sure.
And then just overall, like, your opinion on what Kirby Smart and the current coaching staff has done with the program. You know, Georgia obviously played for a national championship. They've got one of the most talented rosters that's out there. As an alum, someone who recently played, what's your view on it and how exciting is what, you know, has developed?
I'm a big, big fan of Kirby. You know, I think he's done a great job. He changed the culture pretty quickly. I mean, they've been competing for national championships, SC championships for the last, two or three years. So I think, you know, hopefully we get one soon. But, you know, for people, I've heard some people say some crazy thing. I'm like, y'all are just confused. It doesn't get much better than Kirby, man. I think he's done a great job.
Is there anything you want to plug about what you're doing or what's going on in your life?
Nah, man, I'm good. I'm got my head down grinding, trying to make something of myself. So I'm excited about what future holds.
Cool, man. Well, Keith, appreciate it, and good luck. Hope to chat with you soon.
Absolutely, man. Appreciate you.
Big thanks to Keith Marshall for being our first guest here on the Dawg Days podcast. If you're a former player listening, think you have some good stories that you want to share, we really like the funny stuff. Hit me up on Twitter at Dayne Young, DayneYoung, and we'll get you scheduled to tell some of your best Dawg Days stories. Also, if you're a sponsor out there, preferably Georgia fan sponsors, because that's what the majority of our sponsors at UGASports.com are, really big Georgia Bulldogs people. We can get you in touch with the folks that handle advertising better than I do. So contact me on Twitter at Dayne Young, DayneYoung. Until next time, appreciate you listening to the Dawg Days podcast.